So if you look at it, we can see the current side here, so we can see our tailings dam, but we'll come back to that. Right, so we see that's our site, that's where we did. So the Handamooka, Croxby, Adelaide to the south, Lake Torrens over here, and then Arabunum up there around Lake Eyre south, Lake Eyre north. So we can see where Borfield A is. Of course, what's not marked conveniently on these maps, of course, is all the springs and other important sites that exist on these things. We can see the large area of Borfield B, or Wellfield B, as they like to say. And that's it. You know, it's large infrastructure. But one of the reasons why they've gone to the desal plant, one of the things that I think when I was on the Great Artesian Basin Committee, is they simply can't get enough water out of the GOB. You know, with the current expansion and then the potential expansion after that, well, yeah, the mega expansion as opposed to just the mega expansion, they probably need 400 million litres a day, which would be sucking every single drop out of every single square millimetre of South Australia's part of the Great Artesian Basin. Not quite sustainable, really. Let alone, you know, economic or anything else like that. You're basically picking a fight with everyone in that part of the GOB and so on. So, they've gone for the desal plant option, which is part of, they can build a bigger and so on, and the distance is about the same. So, I think that's why the logic is that, you know, but they'll keep this. Haven't committed to even shutting that down as part of the expansion. So, but these issues will just continue to be there for a long time. Now, this is a photo I use quite a lot. It's the bubbler mount spring, and you know, anyone from BHP will automatically say, but that's outside the influence of where the impacts are from Borfield A. Well, no, it's actually on the margins. And there is a debate about whether there are impacts at this site or not, but it's these systems, natural systems. You can see variability in the way they behave, etc. But and these are very important cultural sites as well as very important biological and ecological sites as well. So in that sense, these are the sorts of risks that have been taken in these regions where there's not much other, you know, regular water coming out of, you know, in these sort of arid, you know, landscapes. So these are critical features. You know, certainly I think at the moment, based on the last 30-odd years, we haven't seen enough outcomes in making sure these types of sites are protected and well protected. Let's move on to tailings. One of the things when I was going through my PhD is sort of dealing with the tailings dam that leaks like a sieve that you might use for spaghetti. The site was actually built on top of sand. It actually, you know, had drill holes every 5 metres in order to work out how much clay there was, and then dug the clay out of the way to build the tailings dam wall with. Exposed all the sand and then wondered why the tailings dam leaked like a sieve. The question is never about, with any tailings dam, is never about if it leaks. The question is always a matter of rate. But one of the problems with the Olympic Dam is they've historically always underestimated the rate at which their tailings dam leak. Because, of course, back in the day, they had a chief executive which said, our tailings dams don't leak. And of course, within a few years, they had to admit that they'd lost billions of litres of water out of the tailings dam at the Olympic Dam. So, at the moment, they're already 7 square kilometres, roughly. Right? And that contains roughly, if we're thinking about the volume, the mass of radioactive waste, about 125 million tonnes, that's that capital MT. It's an important number to keep a hold of, but we'll come back to that. But at the moment, the current expansion will add probably another 2.6 billion tonnes above ground in an area where, because of the depth of the ore body, there is no natural radiation signature of the ore body at the surface. So we're now adding radioactive waste, billions of tonnes of it potentially, into an area that doesn't have that sort of material at the surface. Now, BHP are proposing as part of the expansion to just cover them up and then just basically say, that's good enough, and walk away. You know, we're engineers, we never make a mistake. And then I can say, well, you want to start rattling off all the accidents, all the things where engineers said nothing could ever go wrong in that year. But we'll see, let's come back to that. So, good guess. So really, when you look at it, I think we've been sold a dove. All that we've got when we looked at the draft EIS, the supplementary EIS, it's pretty much business as usual. Nothing much is going to change. You know, the way BHP, they said, oh, we'll manage it better, but that's just because they'll slightly reduce the rate of seepage per unit area, maybe. But largely, it's business as usual. Nothing much is really changing in the Olympic Dam. Same with the way they're processing the ore, except maybe chucking the concentrate to China. So largely, it's pretty much the same as. So if we look at it, when we're looking at tailings dams, as I say, it's not a matter of if, you know, it's always a matter of how much. Now, what is the rate of that leakage? I could say leakage, I could say seepage. You know, you can, you know, play word games sometimes, for out of you might be proud, but What I'm more interested in, and what I think is the key issue, is what are the long-term impacts? What are the long-term risks? Right. So where does it go? If it leaks, it's got to go somewhere. You know, we have this debate constantly with Ranger, where they say, oh, it's the world's most regulated mine. And we'll say, fine, you can't even tell me where the seepage goes. Then you get to the impacts. You say, well, often there are no impacts. You say, well, you're not even monitoring. How can you say there's no impacts? Right. So if you look at Olympic Dam, a lot of that comes back to that same old point. They constantly underestimate both the rate, the pathways, and the impacts. Then when you look at the expansion, what that really comes down to is, sure, that BHP might be used to take it slightly better than WMC did. And so the rate might be slightly lower per square kilometre than, say, that historically been the Olympic Dam. But when you've gone from 7 square kilometres of tailings to 44 square kilometres of tailings, and this is only, you know, the first mega expansion, we're still expecting another mega expansion, then really we're going to, the total volume and the total impacts are going to go up long term. Right? And that's something I'm not convinced has actually been addressed properly. And the reason why I say that is not because I want to say that, because I've visited sites like Radiant Hill, I've been through central Western Australia, I've been to places like South Africa, where you look at scales and tailings dams or sites where we have done things like put a cover over the tailings and pretend that we can walk away from that sort of thing and believe it's going to work forever. Come back 10 years or 20 years later, you've got nice big erosion scars or you've got other problems that exist. These things don't work perfectly. So we can't get something for nothing. That's not the way nature works. So in that sense, when we're looking at a lot of these sort of things, we need to get mindful. Yes. Right? So, you know, one of the big issues which has come out of the expansion, and again, I think this is one of these sort of myths and so on, is that people say, oh, it doesn't matter if it leaks because there's limestone underneath. And everyone knows that if you mix acid with limestone, all you get is salt and water. Well, sure, if you have perfect mixing and everything else, and and maybe pigs could fly as well, then that might work. The problem is that's not the way, you know, limestone works. You know, now, if I could ask, you know, locals in South Australia to name one of their World Heritage sites in South Australia, does anyone know which one it would be? Mark, you're rocking grants as well.
World Heritage?
No, it's actually Narrabod Cave. Narrabod Cave.
Joint fossil site.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you go to the Nullarbor Plain, you get huge caves. Huge caves because they're limestone. Right, those caves open up because you get seepage going through, and over time it dissolves up some of that limestone, and you get caves formed. Right, that's with rainwater, which is sort of, you know, a very small amount of acidity in it. Start adding on highly acidic tailings on top of all of that, and you can see why they lost billions of litres of water in the early days of the Olympic Dam. Right, so in that sense, and I don't say this because I actually have no evidence, and I don't say this because I want to, partly it's obvious, it's good common sense science. But we already know that it's happened at Olympic Dam. The small desalination plant that already exists at Olympic Dam to basically produce drinking water for the township and so on. We can see that in the top left there. It's got, you know, small ponds associated with it. They were plastic lined and so on. In the early 90s, they lost the whole thing because they had this little thing called a cave open up. And that was just with desalinated water, with fresh water, basically. All right, so start adding on really acidic water at a scale of billions of tonnes, and then say, well, that's not going to cause these types of problems.